Hey guys, it's System, and this is FTB University. Hope everyone is well, have a base day. I'm myself, really good one. Had a good weekend. Hope you guys had a good weekend too. And in between episodes, haven't done too much, just a little bit here. Went ahead and made these here, insulated LV wire coils, because a lot of you guys told me to make these, so I stopped electrocuting myself. So I went ahead and made them. There you go. Not too bad, just take hemp. Just extra hemp there. Just get that done. And I just put them on all the wires, so I won't get zapped anymore, because, that was definitely happening. Anyway, let's close that. There we go. Head down here, and then I also widened this room. So this room didn't go this far before. I just moved it kind of over the wall, over this way, just so it's kind of symmetrical, and we have a lot more room for machines. You can see here it's still a bit of a mess, but I need to be able to access a lot of things until we get our auto-crafting set up. So that is definitely a thing, and these things aren't connected to anything right now, so they're just kind of sitting there. So that's a thing. Saves this and this. I'm going to move that around. I need to find a home port. So we'll do that in time. But I also added these. These are energy cells from AE2. I think there was a quest associated with those. Go to apply to logistics. Hunt it down. It's right here. There you go. Energy cells store AE power, acting as a backup in case the network stops receiving it externally. But it does more than that. They don't really... Oh, they give you a free dense one, actually. Let's go ahead and put that in there, because I only made the basic ones. Let's put one of those in there. I'll end up making two of these, but go ahead and throw the dense right there. Basically, if you move a whole lot of items in and out of the system really quick, every time you move a single item out, it costs a certain amount of power, right? So I don't know what it costs, but there's a cost kind of associated to it. And I was moving items in and out really quickly, trying to get things all moved around. And these would actually run out of power, because each one of these only holds 16,000 RF. And it would just turn off for a little bit. So I went ahead and added the batteries, so it stops doing that, right? So that's definitely a thing. But if you ever find you're crafting or moving items really fast, and these kind of go dark, and the power goes out of them, that's why you need a battery. So went ahead and did that. Then also I added this machine here. It is the Fluix aggregator. Is from Lazy AE2, and it's really useful. So let's go here, go to use on that, check that out. It's going to give us recipes for mostly the materials from the mod itself, but also adds one for the fluid crystals, which is really nice because you can make them really easy. But my main one was for this here, the fluid steel and the carbonic. Before that was costing more, right? So it's 2, 2, and 1. Here it's just 1, 1, and 1, so way cheaper. But you can also jump the process of making the fluid steel itself in the machine right there, right? So make that easier, because usually we had to smelt that down previously, and that skips that step. So it's a really good machine all around. We also need one of these here, these resonating crystals. So I went ahead and already made one of those. We have it right here, and we're actually going to take that and pop that in here, get another material from this mod. So we just get that done. Sweet. I should probably have those in there. There you go. And make one of these new kind of circuits here, massively parallel processors. And what that's going to do is give us this machine over here called the Pulse Centrifuge, hopefully. I can't remember what we need. Nope, we actually already have everything. Go. And probably throw that up here somewhere. I'm just going to break all this stuff because it's going to get all changed around anyway. There we go. And what this one does is it's really useful. Actually, you go to use on it. It's going to make it so we can grind down our skystone dust much easier, because we can already make the piers easy enough. We can already... Actually, can I do ender dust? Actually, it's going to give me one for the ender dust as well, because I had to do that in the quartz grindstone. And I guess that main one, though, is the skystone dust, because I was having to do that with the grindstone by hand. And a flower recipe? What's that for? I guess there's cookies and stuff. Either way. So that's good. I'm going to go ahead and grab some skystone. Let's do that. I know I needed a bunch of this, so I'm just going to start grinding that down, getting that going. There you go. And I'll start making that. So that's good there. So we have, some extra machines here to kind of help us with the mod itself, which is cool. The next thing I probably want to do, actually, is I want to do this. I want to do a quest in here, actually. And I don't usually do this in playthroughs because people get really confused by it really quickly, but I think I have a way of kind of showing it really simply. We're going to do a little P2P, which is, well, I'll read it here. P2P is one of the more complex and definitely the most useful concepts in AE2. A pair of P2P tunnels will essentially teleport certain things from one end to the other. You can only move one input channel, but several output channels. The most common one is the P2P tunnel, which is what we're going to use to move our channels around, which teleports channels. Being able to teleport connections is staggeringly powerful. A pair of P2P tunnels only uses 2 channels, but can transfer 32. And it goes down and tells you can move up to 1,024 channels. We won't be going that heavy, but you can have 32 channels of 32 channels and move 1,024. And we'll kind of show how you do it with the memory card and stuff. So let's go ahead and get that part done first. Then we'll start moving some channels around, I guess. Let's grab, how many of these do we want? I think it was 6 I wanted, so we'll grab that. We're also gonna want some anchors. Let's go ahead and grab them. Let's do this. No, I said anchor. Wait, let's go ahead, I guess, and grab one of these first. There you go. Go ahead and grab some cable anchors. There you go. And there's just some flux cable. And I think I made a good batch of that. There you go. So we'll kind of get this going. This is going to end up down here. Doesn't really matter where this goes. I'm going to have the multi-block here. So I'm actually going to put these down here. But we're basically going to group up a whole lot of our channels into a nice little way for us to move them around using a lot less of the actual cabling from AE2. It's kind of the concept, right? So let's go ahead and go down there. Probably want a torch down there too. There you go. Go ahead and pop it right there. And all I'm going to do, so I'm going to try to keep this as simple as possible, right? Actually, before we do this, we need better cabling. We need dense cable, right? I'll actually have them over here. These are going to make it so we can move stacks of 32 channels, because otherwise we can't actually move 32. So let's go ahead and do that. These cables are pretty expensive, though. So you kind of do this, then you do that. Then we go ahead and grab this. Awesome. Go ahead and drop that off. Then we want to turn those into smarts. These are going to make it so we can actually see how many channels are being used. So the smarts are usually definitely the way you want to go with this. But we're going to go ahead and put that down there. It says 0, 32 channels. That's what we want to see. We'll put a cable anchor here. And we want to keep all these channels kind of separate, right? So we don't want them to intermingle. That's why I'm putting these anchors here. It makes it so they can't exchange information, basically. So we'll just go like that. And there we go. Put one here. That looks good. Then one more here. And pop that there. So that's kind of good there. Then we're going to go down here a little lower. Go ahead and grab our P2P2 tunnels. Go ahead, toss them right on there. Awesome. Going to get this nice little line here. Everything's going to line up. And right now, these, you can see, they say device online. So the way we want this kind of work, right? We don't want any other cable to touch these. Otherwise, they're going to start pulling those channels and start using the channels in weird ways. That's why we have the anchors there, right? Keep everything separate, like I said. So we're going to power this in a little kind of jank way. I'm just going to kind of come across here, right? Just do that. Awesome. And I'm going to have to move this one, I guess. Let's go ahead and get that out of there. Go ahead and grab one more anchor. Do that right there. Pop an anchor right there. Awesome. And then we're going to run the flux cable straight into this controller here. So that, and that. And basically all that's doing right now is, I may move that too, because I think that counts as a channel, but it doesn't matter too much. But basically what we're doing right now, those P2Ps aren't doing anything by themselves. All we did was grab them, power them, and now the system goes, hey, we got some dense cables down there with 32 channels not doing anything. So that's basically what we want right there. So that looks good. I'm going to have to change this cabling too. All my cabling is going to have to move. Anyway, let's go figure this out. I'm going to go ahead, maybe pull this right here. That'll work. Go ahead and break you, and break you. And we're going to start moving these channels around. That's kind of the idea, right? So let's go over here. There we go. I want to go ahead and grab some flux. We should be able to just use regular flux for this. This is kind of part of the reason I'm doing this, right? Just so we can use a reduced amount of cabling. Because, like I said, that cabling, the dense, gets really expensive really quickly, right? So let's go ahead, bring this over here. Go ahead and start moving our flux cable. There we go. And the first machines we're probably going to automate are going to be these ones. So we need some channels there, right? So we're going to bring some channels up to there. There we go. And we're going to do it this way. So that should be good. Right there. Actually, that works, right? So I can run that. I can run the... Yeah, let's do it this way. We'll need a P2P. We'll need a P2P and a memory card. So let's get P2P. Now let's just grab tunnel, I guess, right here. Awesome. Grab one more of these. Then a memory card. Awesome. Grab this puppy. That looks good. Awesome. Got point to point. We're getting some quests done. And basically what I'm going to do now is let's just put a block here for a second. There we go. Go down here. Going to go ahead, run this P2P tunnel straight into this, right? So it's just kind of going there. Hey, you know what I mean? I'm a P2P. I'm not doing anything yet, basically. And then we're going to go ahead and throw one ME dense cable right here. That's awesome. Then we need to move channels into there. And the way we're going to do that is actually with the memory card. So I can go to any of these now, these P2P channels down here, and kind of link up one of these P2Ps with that one over there. So if I shift and right click on there, you'll see it actually got kind of like a color code there. So it's like two blue. It looks like a pink and a black. That doesn't really matter. It's just like a color code telling it what channel it's on. It'd be like if we were coloring an ender chest, right? And it says the frequency, 3F36. It's got a way of being able to look at them and just go, hey, that one's linked to that one, right? But anyway, let's go down here. Then we just right click on this one, and we just moved 32 channels from that one over there through this cable to here. So from all the channels from that one side of the controller down here are moved over here like that. And this is only costing us one channel right here. We're only using one channel on this side right here. So this side here, we're using one channel to move those 32 channels over here, which we could use down here to automate machines. And if I get down to a point, I say, hey, I need more channels. I could throw in another P2P and do it again, right? So that's kind of the idea. That is kind of how P2P works. It's that simple. It's super easy. And then I can go ahead and say, when we go to this side, I'll run, some channels off this cable down here. And then I'll probably throw one smart cable here too, just to know how many channels I'm using off the side here and one here, but I don't need a dense. I'll probably just use the regular smarts, and that'll probably be pretty helpful for us actually. Yeah, I may do that right now. Let's go grab a smart cable. Nope, these ones right here, right? Yes, we have to make a couple covered. There we go. Go ahead and grab a regular smart. These ones don't handle as many channels. These ones are just 8, right? So let's go ahead and grab them. Awesome. But again, they're good for, apparently I'm smart. Look at this. But we'll be able to tell just by looking at this, it should update. One channel of 8 is being used in that line. So it's good to have these just in like certain spaces, right? Just knowing exactly what's using channels, like right there, that's using 6. This one's powering this plus all of these P2Ps. So that's kind of why that one's using 6 there. So just keeping track of your channels and just getting it done really easy. This one might be better off with a dense, actually. I'll probably put a dense on that one, but we have it right here, actually. There we go. Awesome, because I'm going to want to run channels that way. There you go. So yeah, I'll still have 32 from this side to move everything around that way, but I'll probably only use 8 because it's only going to be moving P2P channels. So hopefully that makes sense. Next, we're going to start automating these machines over here. And okay, the next thing we're going to do here is probably go ahead and hook up our entire barrel wall back there, which is going to probably get moved at some point. But for right now, I need to be able to just access all the items in there and make sure I can see them by with the system, right? So we're just going to do that really quickly. We need to make a ME interface. So let's go ahead and grab one of them. Then we'll pop that in there and then go ahead and grab the storage bus, which is the one we actually need. There we go. Awesome. And then we're going to run a line from this cable here all the way down to the actual barrel controller, right? So let's go to fast for a second. Sweet. Let's try not to do that too much. Go ahead and do that. Just go along. Walking down the line, I'll probably have to go grab some more flux cable too, but that isn't that big a deal. There we go. Awesome. And then we'll want to plug this directly into this, right? So we'll just go down here, close off that block because we don't need it. Plug it into here and then run cable all the way back, right? So that's going to be the way we do it. It's a little jank, right? But at the same time, you're going to have to use some cabling. But at least I'm not using, you know, dense cable for all this, right? So that's kind of the idea. I'm going to have to keep track of the amount of channels on that one cable we are using, which is, I think it's currently at 1. No, we're not even using it. Oh, yes, we'd be using 1 for the P2P on that channel right now. Oh, we ran out of cable. Also, it thinks these are the same items for whatever reason. But anyway, let's go grab a few more flux. Head out here. Here we go. Hunt down some flux. Probably gonna have to make some more of these as well, actually. Let's grab some flux. Oh, I have them right here. I could just grab them like this. Grab ourselves a little bit more quartz fiber. Gonna have to set up a recipe to automatically crush down that at some point. Grab that there. It always wants to grab the pures first. It's a little kind of annoying, but you usually want to use these ones first. So we'll just go ahead and do that. There we go. That's good. That should be enough cabling for us. And then get this hooked up, and then we should be able to see our iron that's in there. We got a whole lot in there, right? Like 38,000 or 48,000, actually. So, yeah, it should be all linked up for the most part. Actually, one more thing I forgot about. Actually, two more things. Let's head down here for a second. Sweet. Down here. You want to set the priority on this to +1, generally. Not always, right? But I want to make sure when I pull items out of one of these barrels, right? If I pull them out either from the terminal or for here and put them back in the terminal, they go back to the barrels first and not a storage disk, right? So that's kind of the idea there. By setting the priority, you kind of do that. Also need to move one of these, but let's slow this down. Or I'm going to take out a bunch of them. There we go. Awesome. and disconnect this drawer wall here. I keep calling them drawers too. Barrel wall. There you go. And now it should be able to see everything in there. Without that drawer there, it wouldn't have seen the connection. But anyway, now we should be able to go to, not there, let's go to number of items. You can see there, 48,000 iron, and it's seeing all of other stuff as well. So that handles that. That just cleans that up really nicely. And I just drop the rest of the stuff off, and everything should go where it belongs, which is very nice. Next thing we should probably do, let's head in here real quick. Actually grab our rewards as well. Grab that, grab that. And that looks good there. So the next thing we're gonna do is probably get into crafting CPUs. We can't do any auto crafting without CPUs, but we'll do this real quick. The crafting CPU is a multi-block machine that manages a single auto craft task from start to finish. CPU must be cuboid, so you can do like a line straight up or a 2x2 or just a 2x1 even. There's all kinds of shapes you can make. One crafting coprocessor unit at least, and some crafting storage. And then also a filler block, right? So you could also do these as filler blocks, I guess, for the multi-block. So if you want to do, say, 3 coprocessors for 4K crafting storage, you need one of these to finish off the 2x2, right? So that's how that works. The more crafting coprocessing units, the more subtasks it can handle at once. For instance, if making a bookcase, it could do logs planks at the same time as paper leather books, so it can like do two parts of the recipe simultaneously. It's kind of the concept. So let's go ahead and actually start making these. We'll be able to make the 4Ks really easy because I got a stack of these, the 1Ks, for doing a task, which is pretty cool. Go ahead and drop that off. Probably need to get some of that cable in there too, so let's do that. You need to make some of these crafting units. These are the blank ones, right? But we're going to make about 16 of those. Let's drop them off. I'm going to jump straight to the 4Ks because, anyway, that's all is what I'm going to do because we have so many of the CPUs, right? And then we'll go ahead and grab some of the co-processing units. We'll grab about 8 of them. And I figured we'd set up about 4 of these. We'll have 4 CPUs, so we can do 4 kind of simultaneous crafting recipes at a time. And I thought I was going to set them up over here. I'm going to end up digging a room below this and doing the cabling different. But for right now, I just want to get them set up. So we're just going to kind of set them up in the middle of the room. There we go. Actually, not that far over. Let's fix that. You can see they're multi-block though. Super simple. Maybe something like this here. There you go. Awesome. Then we'll do the same kind of pattern because that'll bother me. There you go. And maybe we'll flip it, right? So that, and that. I'll probably make these bigger in the long term too. I like having a fair amount of the coprocessors just so I can do lots of subtasks. Are those lined up? Yes. Okay. So we got 4 of these. Each one of these multi-blocks are only going to use 1 channel. So we're going to do a tiny bit more P2P just to make sure you guys get the idea of it, right? So over here, the one we first set up that's linked up, right? This one right here is actually a input. You can have 1 input to a P2P tunnel. You can have multiple outputs. So we're going to output more of the channels that are coming here, these 32, we're going to divide it up and run 4 of them over here. So that's going to be the idea. Let's make sure it's kind of lined up here. Actually, we can use that block right there. Pop it right there. And since we have this memory card, it's already set to the right channel, 3F36. We could just right-click it on there. And now that has 32 channels open to it. Of course, like I said, we're only going to use 4 of them. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't actually take any channels from it until you use them. So it doesn't really matter that much. Let's grab ourselves a single smart so we can track our channels, right? There you go. And then we're going to be using 1 more channel on this line. So we're actually using 3 channels on this line now. But I'm already aware of that. But anyway, let's dig down here. We're going to have to get under this, I guess. I need to make sure we can get to everything. I want to do it fairly cleanly. Maybe I'll do this by myself for a second. There we go. I got this about set up here. So we just brought a channel here. Run a channel there, and like I said, I'll probably end up changing this, but I just need to get it set up right now. So let's do that right there, that right there, and all these should be on that network now, just using 4 of those channels, which is exactly what we want. So let's actually fill this in. Sweet. It's like it never happened, man. It never happened. Awesome. There you go. And we should be able to look at that now, and it should say 4 channels on it, right? 4 of 8 channels. So it's just using 4 of the channels that are in that 32 off that same face. So we're not even to a new face yet. It's still working off this one face of the controller. And there's 32 here too, right? So we have all kinds of channels. And that is the joy of P2P. But anyway, that is cool. Go ahead and drop that off. There you go. And now we can effectively do some auto crafting. So let's go ahead and do that next. go ahead and grab an interface. We probably need some of these. Let's go ahead and grab them. Go ahead and grab some annihilation cores. That's good. And sweet. So we can only do auto crafting right now for machines. It's the only thing we can do right now. So the machines we're going to do first probably are these ones, because they're going to help us do everything else with the mod, right? Anyway, I'm going to go ahead and break this real quick. I'm going to do a step here that a lot of people don't do. I noticed a ton of people don't do this, actually. You can kind of aim these so they actually kind of push their items in a set direction. So I'm going to go ahead and go to the top of them and just right click on them, just like that. And it's going to push the arrow, so it's pushing into the machine, right? The only reason I do this is these things, these interfaces, try to push items to any inventory that's around them. So if I even put a chest over here, it may get some of the items from the auto-crafting recipes that you set up. Now, if you're never going to do that, it's not really a worry, but I like to just, I mean, it's one click, right? So wait, get that done. That looks good. And now we should be able to automate processors really easily. So I made this too. This is the pattern terminal. Let's go to pattern and check that out. It's super easy recipe, actually. It's just one more step after the crafting terminal. So I got that done. But we should effectively be able to make the actual recipe. So let's go to, I guess, processors. There. Oh, let's go to the right terminal, right? Oh, actually, before we do that, we need some patterns. Patterns are going to be what we encode the actual recipes on. So let's go ahead and grab a good amount of these, maybe like 32 of them. There you go. Start that off. Then we make 32 recipes, right? Then if I want to make, say, a logic processor, you have a little button here. This is important. So this is the craft terminal, right? You have a processing pattern and crafting pattern. So if I'm on crafting and I try to do these ones that have to be done to a machine, it's going to give it a little warning. It says must be set as the set the pattern terminal to processing mode. So that's what we'll do, right? So let's go ahead and do that. But we'll go over to this one. Just shift click it in. There we go. We've got a recipe just like that. Now we just repeat that process for all three of these processors. Get them all out of the way. And this is how easy it is to actually start auto crafting with AE2, which is awesome. We can then shift click this up here. You have a bunch of slots here too. This is for like stocking items in the inventories. Kind of like keeping them a certain amount kind of ready to go. We don't have to do that though. We don't need that at all for this, so I'm not too worried about it. This machine is sighted as well, so we're going to set up that way. Oh, that was input though. Is that input? Yeah, input. There we go. And we should be able to start the recipe, right? Then we'll handle output afterwards. Let's go to processor. Yep, we have the least of these ones because you usually end up using the most of these. Is that not hooked up? It helps if I hook up the back of it. Let's actually hook up the back of it. Let's grab some flux here. Sweet. Let's go ahead and grab flux. Sweet. Anyway, there you go. Awesome. Then we'll come around here, I suppose. Pull some channels. There you go. It's going to see, use three more channels here. So we should see this say 3 of 32 in a second. Maybe. There you go. 3 of 32, which is awesome. And this should be up to 7 of 32. This is our initial kind of 32 channels. So everything's working the way it should. Then now we should be able to actually do our processors, right? So if I go here, go to craft, tell the craft, say 3 of them. Let's do that. Should see that. I can see the machines moving, right? So it's actually already done the craft. It's already finished. Now we need to be able to do the output. We're going to do an output out the back. And this is something I see people do in a janky way. And, I'm going to show you. Anyway, most people do this. They usually do an import bus. This is how you do it. This uses a channel though. And I could, right, throw this import bus right here, pull it out the back because this machine can't auto eject. If a machine could auto eject, say like Ender.io, where you can do the push pull, you can push it right back in the interface and it'll tell the system that it's received the item and it's finished. You could do it with one channel. With a machine like this that does, like it does have push pull, but doesn't actually automatically eject, you have to use two sides, right? So a lot of people will go and they'll throw an ambient import bus on it. That's really ineffective. And we're not going to do that because I don't like being inefficient. So what we're going to do instead is pull the items out, say through here, I guess. Actually, even better, this would be the bottom, right? Let's go right here. There we go. This would be even better because we have cables down here. So let's utilize that cable space, right? Let's go down there. Awesome. And then I guess I would need an anchor here. Go ahead and grab that. Pop that there. Gonna go grab one more interface really quickly. Let's go to here. Actually, we have three of them on us. That's even better. Awesome. So as long as the AE system sees an item that was supposed to be crafted come into the system, it works, right? It'll do its job. So basically what I'm doing here is going to hook it up to, oh, not there. Get out of there. There we go. Throw it in between there. Then we just need that hooked up to this channel here. it'll only use one channel, where if I use three imports, this would be three channels, right? Plus, I can use this for more machines down the line as well, which is nice. I do need to get into there for a sec. There you go. I need to be able to set that to insert. There you go. It'll never need to extract, so no point of that. Then I guess down here, I just need to set these all to extract. Extract, extract, and extract. Awesome. And now I should be able to just take this, right? And I guess it would change the output here. And we're going to go to output down there. And hopefully it pulls. Why aren't you pulling? I have something set wrong. Oh, I totally have that wrong. Did I mess this up? I did too when I came in here. There we go. Right? Nope. I need that on the power. There we go. Insert. There we go. I just derped that up. There you go. Go through the craft. Get everything finished. And yeah, just one channel. Just way cleaner. So I went ahead and set up a couple more recipes here. I have the fluid steel ingot, the fluid crystals, and also I did a crusher with the fluid dust. I need to make a big batch of this fluid steel ingots. We need like 200 or so, might be even more than that, to be able to do the size of a mass assembler that I plan on doing. So I'm going to do a pretty big one so we never have to do it later on. That's kind of the plan. I'll kind of sort through that as I go and do it here in a couple minutes. But everything is kind of set up for that now. So if I go to, let's just go to steel, I suppose. Let's do this, do that. The whole point of this was to get this stuff going, right? So if I start that now, I should be able to just go ahead. And everything should start being made. I have a bunch of pulverized coal in the system, so I didn't automate that yet. I really just want to get this assembler going, then everything else will kind of come together. So I'm going to go ahead and do this, get this all crafted up, and then we'll probably just set up the assembler, get the multi-block done, and be able to do our kind of auto-crafting on 3x3 recipes, which is the plan. This one here was a little different too, the crusher. Have to input through the top, export out the bottom. It does have auto eject though, so some of you might be saying, hey, he just said you could auto eject into these, but these ones can only do it one direction, right? So the side of the machine could either be an input or output. You can't do in and out on mechanism machine, so that is why I did that. And everything else is working. I got all the sides fixed. I fixed the power on these ones that I disabled on the bottom, and everything's just going good in life, so that is awesome. I should be able to actually just pop these in here, right, and speed that right up. Yeah, look at it. It's doing its thing. It doesn't even use that much power. That is like near nothing. That is actually fantastic. So I'm going to go ahead and do a whole bunch of crafting here. Once I'm done, we'll come back and set up the mass assembler. And okay, I think I have pretty much everything we need here. So let's go ahead and just fill that in. I moved this back a little bit because that's the way I want it. But we're going to go ahead and put these here too because they belong here. Oh, this one's been in the wrong place the whole time. How has no one told me? Anyway, that's good. Awesome. I did have to add a few more recipes there. So I had to add enderpearl dust, what's this one here? The resonating crystal, because I needed the ender dust for that. And then I needed the resonating crystal for these, which were the massively parallel processors, but I got them all done. And I got everything we need for the multi-block, I think. So we'll kind of see here in a second. The thing was a lot more expensive than I thought. It took a lot more fluids, but I did move this back kind of in preparation for this. But the shape we're going to build is going to be, I think it's like a 6x5? Little wonky shape. I downsized it. I was going to do, what would it have been? 6x8, I guess, is what I was planning. And I realized it's probably way too big. So anyway, you could probably get away with a 1x2 interior. But I wanted to go big or go home. So anyway, let's go up here. Let's check this out. Get this kind of all built here. It has to be in a cuboid shape, cuboid, I guess I should say. And I don't know what the max size is at all whatsoever. I don't know enough about this mod yet. We'll go read the quest there in a second. It didn't complete either, actually. It was really odd. I guess it is odd. I have all the blocks, but it didn't complete the quest. But not too worried about that. I don't think there was a reward for this one. So I guess it doesn't matter that much. I may have to bug report it if it doesn't pop up, though. Because we definitely have all the blocks. But anyway, go ahead and build this. Get it all kind of put together. That looks good. On the inside, you can put two different blocks. So there are coprocessors and pattern providers. Coprocessors are going to be the ones that speed up the work, right? So it's going to make it faster, let it do more than one task at once. The pattern providers are going to make it so it can hold, I think every one is 36 recipes is what this thing is going to be able to hold. So I went with two rows of this. So that's going to be 24 for the shape. So kind of like that there. Oh, I haven't put the roof in yet either. Let's go ahead and finish off the roof because otherwise I'm totally going to mess that up. That looks good. And okay, I was going to say, I thought I was missing one. Anyway, let's go ahead and grab the coprocessors. Sweet. And also the pattern providers. I'm actually going to leave one out because I want to see one thing I never tested with this thing when I took it into creative was able to let you have an empty spot and then kind of fill it up as you want. So you can just kind of build the outside frame and then fill it up later on. Outside of that, I guess I need more vents. So let's do that. Sweet. And then we got to put in a controller somewhere. I'm going to put the controller right here because it needs to connect to power. And this way it'll be able to connect to power right off that line right there. Then probably just come across. And once we've done that, all we should have to do is right click this. There you go, turn blue, which is a nice sign. I'll have to fix up there. This is why I was going to make it taller, but I'll do that later on. But you can see here, MA chamber. And then it has how many coprocessors it has, how much work it can do, and then 11 pages. Actually, is that 11 pages? Yeah, because I put 11 in. I was going to say, I thought I had 12. So if born two, I guess what we did find out there was that it born with an empty spot in it. And that's the one thing I was trying to test there. So let's go do that and put this here. There we go. Then go ahead and right click that again. There we go. This thing should be ready to go. So I actually already did two recipes here. I did one to teach it to turn oak to planks. And another one to do crafting tables, just so we could test it, right? So we just toss those in there, hopefully. Okay, on the first page, there you go. Then we're going to go ahead and say, I guess, crafting tables. Let's go ahead and do a good amount of them. So we should be able to do, let's do like a stack of them, just so we can see if it's working. There, see it everything, it's doing everything. That looks good. We'll click start, go to here, and either it's done. Okay, it is doing it. I thought it showed you here. There you go. So it's grafting it up and it's good to get done. So it's doing the thing. It did the stuff and it's already finished. So that is actually really cool. Oh, it messed up though. Why'd it mess up? Wait, did that mess up? Let's try that again. Let's go back to here. Let's go to, I guess, crafting table, right? Crafting. Pull those out. I don't mind making a bunch of these either because it's one of those things that just always is needed, right? Anyway, let's do that. To about 20. Why is it doing 4 sometimes? That's a little weird. Anyway, it finished that time. So maybe I pulled one out the first time or messed something up, but it looks like it's working. It's looking like it will do the recipes now, which is really fantastic. And that's actually a pretty cool multi-block. And I guess we can hold, what is that? 10 times 36, 10 times 360. We can do about 400 recipes in this puppy and it should be good to go. So for now on, whenever we want to automate anything, we can. Between this and just interfaces and channels, we'll be able to automate everything. I'm pretty sure this thing only uses one channel as well. So I guess we'll find out, I think. Anyway, actually, we should probably test that. I didn't actually test that. Let's go to, we just need a smart cable. Let's go ahead and grab a smart cable. Let's do that. Awesome. Let's go ahead and pull you off for a second and pull you off. Go ahead and throw a smart here. And it should just say one channel, right? One channel. Yeah. This entire multi-block takes one channel, which is actually pretty rad. I shouldn't have done that. But anyway, let's go ahead and pop you off, you off. Let's get everything back in place like it's supposed to be. Sweet and sweet. And that is awesome. Except for this. This needs to be fixed. This is going to drive me crazy. I'll probably just put black blocks around it for now until I can make it bigger. It was just too much work, man. It was tons of stuff. But now I can do this. I can automate pretty much all of it. And that's pretty cool. And our area is looking awesome all around. And okay, at least I have it sealed off so you can't see in between. But this is really bothering me. I'm going to have to do something about that. Maybe I'll work on making it one taller in between episodes. Or maybe even one less far back. Maybe, you know what I mean? Just so I can push it one taller. That would probably work out actually because it doesn't have to actually be that shape. But I want it flush with this. I just want it flush, man. And yeah, I'll probably move it one board. So that'll be a thing. Probably make a room for these and push these down a little further as well into the floor. That's kind of the plan. And I'll probably just stick with 4 though, like we have. Maybe in the future we'll make them a little taller though. So I'll leave a little room for that. So that is cool though. I think I'm going to go ahead and actually wrap this one up here. So as always, if you guys like this video, please hit that like button. Really liked it. Hit that subscribe button. It is much appreciated. Well, you guys all have a good one. See you guys in the next video. Later.